Good afternoon, colleagues. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. I'd remind members wishing to ask a supplementary question that they should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant questions. We're focusing on education and skills with the usual plea for brevity in both questions and answers. And I call question number one, Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with the UK Government and universities regarding the potential impact on visas for international students at Scottish universities of any delays in marking assessments.
Minister Graham.
Presiding Officer, although immigration arrangements are fully reserved, it's vital that Scotland attracts and retains talented people to study and work here without undue barriers. Whilst the Scottish Government welcomed the launch of the graduate visa, we continue to engage with the UK Government on ways to improve the system so that it reflects our specific economic, demographic and social needs. On industrial action, I am of course concerned about any adverse impact on students, but I know our universities are putting in place appropriate mitigations to minimise disruption to studies, and I would expect this to include mitigations for international students. These are being worked up currently. While matters concerning pay and working conditions are for universities to determine on a UK-wide basis, I would encourage Scottish university employers and trade unions to engage in constructive and meaningful dialogue in pursuit of a resolution.
Thank you, Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for that response. He will be aware that the current marking assessment boycott is part of over 4 years of industrial action, including strikes by UCU members, because their pay and conditions continue to degrade. They know their actions will affect students, but staff employment conditions are students' learning conditions, and the deterioration of one is bad for the other. Ensuring the quality and timely administration of degrees, including for international students, is the responsibility of university management. Can the Minister outline what further engagement is planned, if any, to ensure management respond to staff concerns about making their lives livable, whether he considers intimidation with financial penalties appropriate, and what more the Scottish Government can do to ensure international students on visas are not adversely affected?
Minister.
Signing officer, but you'll allow me a moment to answer that in some detail. Universities are autonomous institutions, and as such, matters concerning pay and working conditions are for them to determine in consultation with trade unions. However, I've met university leaders and will be meeting UCU in coming weeks, and I'm encouraging all concerned to get back around the table, because industrial action benefits no one, least of all the students. Regarding the possibility of institutions imposing financial penalties on those staff involved in the marking boycott, I would expect Fair Work principles to be applied, and I was pleased to see Queen Margaret University step back from their initial stance in this regard. In response to concerns over the impact on international students, the Scottish Funding Council and Quality Assurance Agency have indicated there is scope for the marking boycott to affect aspects of international student studies. I understand there are circumstances in which students can apply to extend their student visa, but there is a cost associated with that. Universities are, I know, taking steps to mitigate the impact of a boycott, particularly on fourth-year students, but clearly all of this would be best avoided. So again, I would encourage both sides to resume discussions.
Question two, Pauline McNeill.
To ask the Scottish Government what it's doing to help educate children and young people about any dangers of online pornography.
Cabinet Secretary.
Through the Scottish Curriculum, Curriculum for Excellence, secondary school pupils learn about the damaging and exploitative aspects of pornography and how it can negatively affect mental health and healthy relationships. Pupils learn about this topic as part of their learning in relationships, sexual health and parenthood education.
Pauline McNeill.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. She may be aware that earlier this month, the Children Commissioner for England published a second report on the impact of pornography on children. The report focuses on the harms that children face from accessing violent pornography and how that might influence their own harmful sexual behaviour, which is why regulation online is so critical to protect children and young people. And I agree with the Children's Commissioner for England that no child should be able to access or watch pornography. But worryingly, the report found that one victim said that abuser made references to things he'd seen on porn. Two young girls said that they felt they had been treated like porn stars by their abuser. Now, I previously mentioned this in the Chamber about the lack of data there is in Scotland. So as the Cabinet Secretary, does she think it's really important to collect this type of data, and that the new Children's Commission for Scotland should consider the collection of this data a priority?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I think she raises a really important matter. I'm not cited on the specific report that she's mentioned in relation to the Children's Commissioner in England. I will certainly be appraised of that following portfolio questions, because I think it's hugely important. We do have a granular understanding of the challenge in Scotland. Of course, in relation to the point she makes around regulation, the regulation of the internet is a reserved matter and falls to the UK Government. And of course, we have been engaging with the UK Government on the Online Safety Bill, which looks at bringing in additional measures to protect vulnerable children online. But more broadly, I think the member makes that a very valid point, and I look forward, of course, to working with the new Children's Commissioner, who will take up post later this year.
Question 3, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to better support teachers and educators who work with learners with ADHD.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, we want all children and young people, including those who have ADHD, to get the support needed to reach their full potential. We work closely with partners, including Education Scotland, to ensure teaching staff have access to a range of free professional learning and developmental resources. This includes free learning modules for practitioners available via the Open University on Inclusive Practice. On the 30th of November last year, we published our updated Additional Support for Learning Action Plan, which outlines further work we will take in this area to ensure that teaching staff continue to receive training to support all children with additional support needs, including those with ADHD.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply, and whilst I recognise that Scotland's teaching staff are committed to providing all children and young people in their care with the support they need to succeed, it has been brought to my attention on too many occasions where, for a variety of reasons, this has not been to the parents' satisfaction. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore indicate whether the Scottish Government will consider publishing updated guidance for teachers and educators about how best to support children and young people with ADHD, including those without a diagnosis but presenting with ADHD symptoms?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think, Presiding Officer, as Stuart McMillan has outlined, in our model of additional support for learning, support in school does not require a formal diagnosis of a particular condition, but I do recognise that a diagnosis can help families and also our young people to understand better how they can deal with and respond to, of course, additional support needs. More broadly, there are other professionals who work in our education sector who are not teachers who can help provide specialism in that regard too. We have committed through our Additional Support for Learning Action Plan to build on and develop a suite of resources that are already available to meet the needs of children and young people. And as part of that work, the Project Board Subgroup on Training and Resources will look to consider how to improve the support for neurodiverse learners, including those with ADHD.
A number of supplementaries. I want to get them all in. They'll need to be reasonably brief, as will the responses. First, Daniel Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd remind the Chamber that I am the Vice Chair of the ADHD Foundation, and I have an ADHD diagnosis myself. With as many as 1 in 5 children in the classroom having a neurodevelopmental disorder, I think that it shouldn't be an optional that actually teachers must all have training in how to teach children with neurodevelopmental disorders. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm to me what conversations she's had with the General Teaching Council of Scotland to incorporate that in initial teacher education?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. More broadly, this issue was raised over the weekend with me directly by a number of teaching unions, and I recognise some of the challenges in our classrooms at the current time. I think it's worth putting on record the increase we have seen in Scotland schools in relation to the number of pupils with additional support needs. So I think since 2010 we've had an increase of over 30%, which is quite substantive. And in the last year alone, we've had an increase of over 8,000 pupils recorded as having an additional support need. It's really crucial that our teaching staff have that professional support that the member spoke to, and of course the GTCS have a crucial role to play in that regard. Now, the GTCS, of course, have a requirement of 35 hours for teachers to complete professional development within the year. It is, of course, at the teacher's discretion where that focus is on, but I very much take the member's point in relation to working with the GTCS on this issue, particularly noting the increase that we've seen nationally in recent years in relation to the number of additional support needs in our schools.
And Pam Gosel.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In February, members of the Education, Children and Young People's Committee, MSPs, were told that the provision for young disabled people when they were move on to from school is a national disgrace. They were also told that for young people transitioning out of school, it is a messy and terrifying place out there at the moment, particularly given the lack of coordinated plans. So can I ask the Minister, with our college and university sector strapped for cash, what action is the SNP Government taking to support the individuals with ASN attending university and colleges?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. I'm not going to answer on the specifics of university and colleges because the question today was very much focused on school education, although I'd be happy to write to the member in relation to that transition period. I recognise that being a challenge potentially with some young people. What I would say in relation to school education is that we do have coordinated support plan CSPs that follow or should follow a young person, for example, as they transition from primary to secondary. And it's really imperative that we in government work with our partners, yes, in the university sector, but also in colleges, to ensure that coordinated support plan is followed through, and I'd be more than happy to write to the member with some additional information in relation to higher education on that specific point.
Ian Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. The questions today have ranged from ADHD to ASN, but to go back to the original question about ADHD, which is a disability, Article 23 of the UNCRC, on which evidence is being taken today, gives a right to special care and education for children with a disability. Can the Scottish Government explain how they're meeting that requirement for special care and education with the support that are being given to ADHD sufferers?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. Of course, we do have the highest record of support staff in our schools at the current time, which I think gives a response to the member's question directly. In 2022, for example, we had 307 additional pupil support assistants that were recruited. That builds on the increase of over 1,000 from the previous year, bringing the total number of pupil support staff in Scotland to 16,606. Of course, that is a direct result of continued investment from this government, but I recognise the member's point more broadly. We will need to go further. We will need to ensure that the increase in additional support needs in our schools is adequately supported in our classrooms. And I committed over the weekend to working with the teaching unions on this very issue, and of course to the member's colleagues on working directly with the GTS for Scotland on the professional requirements for teachers as they undergo teacher training.
Question 4, Jeremy Balfour.
Chief Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to roll out universal free school meals.
Cabinet Secretary.
We remain committed to the expansion of free school meals in primary and special schools as described in our programme for government. All primary schools and primary school pupils in primaries 1 to 5, children in funded early learning and childcare, and eligible pupils in primary 6 through to S6 can benefit from free school meals in Scotland, the most generous provision of anywhere in the UK, and saving parents around £400 per eligible child per year. Our additional investment announced in December 2022 will continue to fund the expansion of free school meals for all in primary 6 and 7 in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment. That will be the next step in fulfilling our commitment to universal provision in primary schools.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer? 3 weeks ago, the Minister said that SNP were committed to plot pilot free school meals for secondary schools. However, the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister have suggested that it should be a targeted approach would be better. Can the Cabinet Secretary clear up this confusion and confirm whether the SNP Government is committed to pilot universal free school meals for secondary schools, and if so, when will it start?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. As he alluded to, I think only 3 weeks ago this was raised in the Chamber. We are very much still committed to that secondary school pilot. It's important that we roll out that pilot to learn from how it might operate in the future. We are very much also, as I intimated in my initial response to the member, committed to that universal provision in primary school. Yes, that is being phased out in a process that looks at in primary 6 and 7, adhering to looking at the Scottish Child Payment as a requirement. However, we remain committed to universal rollout in primary and to the secondary pilot that the member mentions.
And briefly, Monica Lennon.
Thank you. At the Food for Thought parliamentary reception last week, the young people made really clear that hunger doesn't end at the primary school gate, so this pilot scheme for secondary is very important. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps government will take to ensure that young people are involved in co-designing the pilot scheme and the ongoing rollout of universal free school meals?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank the member for her question. I wasn't in Parliament last Thursday, however, I saw from social media that it was well attended, and I very much look forward to working with the member on this issue. We've discussed it, I think, at the previous portfolio questions. To her specific point on co-design, I think she makes a very valid contribution. I'd be more than happy to meet with the member on this. I haven't yet met with officials to talk to some of the proposals in relation to the secondary school pilot and how that might be administered in the future, but more than happy to engage with the member on this really important issue for our young people and, of course, with our young people directly on the rollout itself.
Thank you. Question 5, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to promote modern apprenticeships to constituents in Motherwell and Wishaw.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, Skills Development Scotland provide an all-age career service in every local authority, highlighting the options available to people across Scotland, including modern apprenticeships, and it undertakes further activity together with employers to highlight the importance of modern apprenticeships, particularly through Scottish Apprenticeship Week. Developing the young workforce also facilitates engagement between employers and schools to highlight vocational pathways and support young people to transition into work. I met young people on work experience at a recent DYW Lanarkshire visit to Innovate Homes in Wishaw in the Members constituency to observe this firsthand, and I was very impressed by what I found.
Claire Adamson.
Thank you very much. Today, I was delighted to attend the skills demonstration outside, hosted by Scottish Traditional Building Forum. I tried my hand at some slate cutting. I don't think it's I see that in my future, but seeing the young people engaging in these endeavours was very, very exciting. I understand the initiative is not yet ready, rolled out across the country. And does the Minister agree that supporting these heritage skills workshops through local schools is vital to promoting rewarding careers and delivering on the objectives of developing the young workforce?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I also tried the slate cutting and I have to admit that the results are sitting in my office, not in public view. The Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee is right to highlight the importance of ensuring that we have the right traditional skills available to sustain our historic environment and progress our journey to net zero. Historic Environment Scotland continue to champion traditional skills and are working with stakeholders to address traditional skill gaps to help ensure Scotland's historic buildings can thrive as part of the country's sustainable future. The role of colleges in all of this will be essential, as will be the partnership working that I indicated.
And supplementary, Megan Gallagher.
Presiding Officer, modern apprenticeships are essential to training and upskilling our workforce. Many constituents across my region will be very concerned about the sector's future and viability. Last week, the Scottish Training Federation said Scottish Government delays in setting its skills and employability budgets this year is having a devastating impact on training providers. Many staff have been made redundant and several are on the brink of closure. If this comes to pass, this will have a devastating impact on my region, including that of Mother One Wishaw. Minister, this is a matter of urgency. When will this government get its act together and support this industry? When will these budgets be confirmed?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, a typically positive contribution from the Conservatives. Presiding Officer, we have been focused on delivering modern apprenticeship, the 25,000 apprenticeships around that. Skills Development Scotland have, as part of that process, as some have not been taken up, been redistributing. We're doing that as we speak. The other thing, in terms of the budget, that's a matter that's been worked on just now, and we will provide further detail in due course.
And brief supplementary, Faisal Jowdery.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Outside Parliament today, there is a construction and traditional skills demonstration where young people from the industry are delivering mini masterclasses to school pupils. I spoke with students who emphasised the importance of industry-based courses at colleges and universities across Scotland. They highlighted how important skill-based labour courses are to our heritage sector and how positively they can contribute to industry recruitment overall. Can the Minister advise how the withdrawal in funding to universities and colleges is expected to impact these essential industry-based courses?
And as briefly as possible, Minister.
Presiding Officer, I think that betrays a lack of understanding of what the £46 million was for. It was for transition funding. The actual teaching grant remained at the same level as last year. Now, I recognise that will still present challenges for some of our colleges and universities, but I know they are committed to preserving some of these skills in partnership with the heritage agencies.
Question 6, not Lodge. Question 7, Sandesh Gulhani.
To ask the Scottish Government what impact the withdrawal of £46 million of funding for colleges and universities has on their ability to deliver courses.
Minister Graham Day.
Now, Officer, the removal of the £46 million does not impact the core teaching fund allocated to colleges and universities for academic year 23-24, which has been maintained at the same level as academic year 22-23, despite the very challenging financial environment. I hear Mr Kerr chuntering from a sedentary position, but as he heard at the Education Committee yesterday, it was for transition purposes, some of which I identified at the committee.
Sandesh Gulhani.
Despite the Minister's answer, Principal and CEO of City of College Glasgow, Paul Little, has said that the loss of this £26 million from the college sector's budget has further compounded significant financial pressures and forced them to compulsory redundancies. Having visited the college, I've been impressed with them, but I'm deeply troubled that budget cuts are leading to over 100 staff losing their jobs. And I've been flooded with letters, with one constituent saying, I urge you to intervene on this matter and to investigate why funding has not been made available to avoid this redundancy situation. My colleagues deserve better treatment than this. Will the Minister offer some support and tell us what support the Government will provide to colleges being forced to consider redundancies?
Minister.
Presiding officer, you really do marvel at the brass neck of the Tories and all of this. Never mind imposing a damaging Brexit on the UK, which would particularly harm the university sector, or the impact of Liz Truss and quasi-quartering trash in the UK.
Minister, could I ask you to resume your seat? We've got through portfolio questions so far, with the questions being asked and the questions being responded to without the heckling. If we could resist from the heckling, we'll get through all of the supplementary questions as well. Minister, resume.
Thank you, President. So I was going to make the point that just this lunchtime, my friend Liz Smith was sat in those very benches calling on this government to take a lower tax approach, which would have meant money being reduced, the money that was available for our public services. You cannot have it both ways. But this is a serious matter, Presiding Officer, and in relation to the colleges, we are actively engaged with them, working on flexibilities and other measures which would help alleviate the challenges, and there are challenges that they face, and improve the situation for them.
Thank you. I've got a number of supplementaries. I don't suspect I'll get through all of them, but I'm going to try and do my best. Firstly, Willie Rennie, briefly.
The Minister knows that there is incredulity and frustration in both the college and university sector that the first step that the Minister took was to cut £46 million from their funding. This won't help them transition to the new future that the Minister wants to see. So if new funds become available, can he confirm this will be his first and top priority for investment?
Minister.
Well, sir, as I said at the committee yesterday, from my perspective, and we've already indicated that we would look to address this going forward, if an improvement in the funding situation became available, then working with colleges and universities, of course, that would be a priority for the education portfolio.
And Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister confirmed this week that the funding had been reallocated to account for the pay deal it reached with school teachers. Does the Minister accept that this reversal of promised funding, combined with more than 10 years of real terms cuts to the sector, is limiting their ability to offer a fair pay deal to staff? And does he accept that teaching staff in all phases of education should be properly remunerated for their work?
Minister.
I do believe that education staff will be properly remunerated for their work, but here we go again. I said this about the Conservatives, even more so the Labour Party. You cannot spend the same money twice. If you want to spend it on one thing, if you want to spend it on something else, then fine, you need to tell us where it came from. Sorry, Labour benches need to tell us where it's come from. But I do want to correct one small point, Presiding Officer, a point of fact. Since 2012-13, college resource budgets have increased by £168 million in cash terms.
And very briefly, Liam Kerr.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer. In its latest accounts, the principal of North East Scotland College warned, if the college is required to reduce costs further, student experiences and outcomes will suffer significantly. Did the Minister consider the impact on NESCOL of withdrawing the £46 million, and what does he predict the impact will be on their ability to deliver?
Minister.
Of course, we were aware that there would be an adverse impact of the withdrawal of those funding because of the transition measures that they were going to fund. But this was not a decision taken lightly. In many ways, there was no decision. The money had to be found. I find that regrettable and disappointed we had to do it. But if Mr Kerr was aware of the conversations that started to happen with all colleges, and that would include North East College, we are looking actively at what we can do going forward to give them the sustainable future that they require.
And question 8, Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting local authorities to ensure that school children from disadvantaged communities have access to after-school clubs and other activities outside the school term.
Minister Natalie Dodd.
Since 2021, we've invested £25 million in summer holiday programmes, which provided activities, food and childcare. Our priority now is to take the next steps in building a system of school-aged childcare, providing year-round childcare support for families on low incomes to support sustainable employment. To do this, we are targeting our £15 million investment this year towards community-based projects, which will deliver year-round childcare and activities. We are rightly focusing on delivering lasting change for those families and communities who need support the most.
Evelyn Tweed.
I thank the Minister for that answer. In my Stirling constituency, there are currently gaps in after-school club provision. Can the Minister advise how support from the Scottish Government could assist local authorities in identifying these gaps and how they would go about applying for this support?
Minister.
The Children's Scotland Act 1995 requires local authorities to consult with parents about their out-of-school care and school-aged childcare needs every 2 years and to plan and publish whether and how they will provide that appropriate childcare, taking account of those responses. Local authorities should therefore have access to appropriate information relevant to their local communities. The approach we are taking, however, building a system of school-aged childcare, is person-centred and place-based, including engaging local communities to support the design and delivery of services initially through our early adopter areas. We will share these findings as well as identifying new early adopter areas this year.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a brief pause to allow front bench to change before we move on to the next item of business.